Penguin Random House Canada presents Speak Silence by Kim Echlin. Read for you by Athena Karkanis. For the women who testified. For Nicole Winstanley. He sat down and lit a cigarette, and he said that he could perhaps do more, much more, but that I was about the same age as his daughter, and so he wouldn't do anything more for the moment. Protected witness. A note on the novel. In 2000, a landmark trial took place in The Hague. The Focha case was in response to the thousands of rapes that took place during the Yugoslav wars, 1992 to 1999, in centers set up as rape camps. Prosecutors needed 6 years to prepare for the trial. An international team of women lawyers and researchers traveled around the world to find women witnesses, now war refugees, who dared to testify. The trial lasted for 9 months. The International Tribunal for the Former Yugoslavia, ICTY, was born out of Nuremberg's remnant hope for enduring international justice. Judges were appointed from 52 nations. 900 people from around the globe worked in the courts. The ICTY was established in 1993 to contest violations of international humanitarian law. Many trials took place during the wars. The Focha trial in 2000 asked us to agree that never again would a woman's body be used as a theater of war. But always, we say never again. To this day, women are systematically raped as part of terror and war. Important new jurisprudence came out of the Focha trial. The perpetrators were found guilty, not only of rape, but of a crime against humanity. For the first time in 5,000 years of recorded history, women were not spoils of war. Rape in war was no longer a crime against individual women, but a crime against all of us. Speak Silence is an imaginative response, in fiction, to changing consciousness. Let us reimagine our humanity together. K.E. Toronto, Sarajevo.
They're still shooting, said Jacques Payac.
I'm going, I said. The borders are open.
I run a travel magazine, he said.
I will write a travel piece.
About war?
About film.
When the hell are you going to settle down?
Why should I settle down?
What are you hoping for?
I only want to know. To tell. I had watched the war on television in Toronto for years. I watched life in a city under siege, saw people from a breadline bleeding on the ground. The cameras pulled back, and I saw smoke and fire from apartment towers. My name is Gota Dobson. I saw these images on the same screen that I watched Looney Tunes with my only child. Intolerable shame. To watch old women in good leather shoes hurrying over rubble along the edges of buildings. To watch boys and girls playing on tanks. To watch people falling like broken clay pigeons in skeet practice. To change the channel. To live in the unattended moment. To be where I was not. There was the time cover of a crowd of prisoners behind wire fences. Their ribs like empty cages, with a caption in red, "Must it go on?" The war did not abate, and the news remained clear and constant, and the world struggled to rouse itself. People knew. Still, it went on. Year after year, I watched. When Biddy was asleep at night and my work was put away for another day, I watched. To know is not enough. So I went to Sarajevo to write about the film festival when they were still fighting outside the city. They ran the projectors off car batteries. Someone asked,
Why are you holding a film festival in the middle of a war? The director answered, Why are they holding a war in the middle of a film festival? I saw the Sarajevo roses in the sidewalks, the pockmarks on the walls. The city was alive with the temporary glamour of international film stars gathering in war ruins. Where was the rage? On the streets, I heard wry humor and relief. I felt mourning, exhaustion. I asked at the Sartre Theater box office, Do you know a man called Kosmos? Yes, said the young woman. Does he have another name? She thought for a moment and said, Everyone calls him Kosmos. I left an envelope for him. Inside was a note in which I told him I would meet him that night at the Kino Bosna. I had not seen him for 11 years. The announcement of a new court in The Hague had spread quickly around the globe. They would need judges, litigators, researchers, interpreters. They would write a new set of rules and procedures. They wanted to bring order into that lawless place, the border. In Hamburg, Carla Vogel Babich applied to be a prosecutor. She was married to a man from the region. Her specialty was international white-collar crime, but she was tired of the greed. When she was a child, she had lost her home in the rubble of her war-flattened city. She knew the smell of decomposing corpses. She wanted to be part of this new thing, a world court. A woman has no country and wants no country. Borders shift and crack into something different. Other women in other places were also deciding to leave their homes to go to The Hague. They too wanted to act. They too felt their home to be the world. In Lusaka, the Deputy Chief Justice told Judge Gladys Banda that the United Nations was looking for African judges. At first, Gladys thought she could not fit in with international lawyers. She had 5 children, but this had never stopped her from doing new work. Her husband encouraged her, and she thought, All the new judges will have to learn the new law too. She had learned how to navigate Zambian tradition and British common law. Perhaps there were things she could do. All over the world, people were weighing the idea of joining the new court. History is now, in the moment of consciousness. New law on the border. The Kino Bosna Cafe was converted from a cinema, seats replaced with tables and red checked cloths, and on the walls, classic black and white photos of old Hollywood stars, Bogart and Hepburn and Monroe. The smoke-filled room was full of young students whose educations had been interrupted, laughing through their war trauma, trying to invent a retro-present in a city besieged for 3 years, 10 months, 3 weeks, and 3 days. They crowded round a game of chess and mocked missteps, called out things like, the chicken has laid a potato. For the young, hope is as natural as violence. They played U2 and Sichter and Protest. They joked, You think one president is difficult? Try 3, a Bosniak, a Croat, and a Serb. But it was not a joke.
Gott?
Kosmos. He sat at a table with a woman. His hair fell over his left eye, and he moved with that familiar kinetic energy. He was pulling over a chair and saying,
What are you doing here?
In his eyes, the ironic distance and intimate warmth I remembered, and I felt all over again blood pulsing beneath my skin. I loved all over again his lifted eyebrows. He said,
This is Athena.
And she looked up, politely, was chain smoking, did not speak. I wondered if she had no English. Her face was sallow, her bony fingers long. The skin around her lips a dry net of wrinkles. Some of her hair was tucked behind her right ear. She had once been pretty. Her shifting gray-blue eyes were more alive than her flesh, her energy an erect snake waiting to strike. He was talking fast. He said that he had stayed away from Sarajevo for too long, Could I not hear his British accent? Was it not fucked up? And was not British English boring, their insults boring? Nothing interesting like fuck my python. He was a little uneasy. Finally, he asked.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.